सर गुड मॉर्निंग, नमस्कार।
गुड मॉर्निंग। थैंक
थैंक यू सर, थैंक यू फॉर ज्वाइनिंग विथ अस।
यू, कांग्रेचुलेशन फॉर हैविंग ए वेरी गुड सेशन। यस्टरडे
थैंक यू, थैंक यू।
आई वाज क्वाइटली लिसनिंग टू सम ऑफ द सेशंस यस्टरडे, सो इट वेंट ऑफ क्वाइट वेल।
या गजेंद्र सिंह जी हैज डिलीवर अ वंडरफुल लेक्चर।
यस
I mean
यस
more than
ओके
30 minutes he has present, and present is really it was awesome. And each and everybody has got very appreciation for
And
his
he
session.
very nicely, almost all aspects he touched upon in a very, very, very articulated lecture.
So sir, we will start within 5 minutes.
Okay.
Just sharply at 11:05 we will start.
Right.
Okay sir, okay, thank you.
Right.
Good morning everyone. Aaj Baishe Shrabon. As we all know that today is the Bengali death anniversary of Bard of Bengal, Rabindranath Tagore, we would like to dedicate this small piece of music to him and start our program.
A very good morning to the distinguished guests, delegates, speakers, and the participants. I am Antara Kundu, Project Executive of South Asian Institute for Advanced Research and Development. I am much honored that I get to be a part of this session with the most esteemed personalities. My heartfelt gratitude to all the esteemed delegates for accepting the invitation and presiding over the second day of our these 2 days national level brainstorming session on restoration of riverine ecosystem and urban planning. This event has been organized by Center for Urban and Built Environment, SIURD, and in association with National Institute of Urban Affairs, Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, Government of India. Further making any delay, may I now request Mr. Arindam Ray, Director, Academic Affairs, SIURD, to brief us about the first day of this 2 days brainstorming session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Antara. A very good morning to all of you. The first day of our two-day webinar was a very significant day where our chief guest was Union Cabinet Minister Mr. Gajendra Singh Shekhawat from Jal Shakti Ministry. And Sri Gajendra Singh Shekhawat ji spoke about the importance of water. According to him, if there is water, there will be a society. The civilization of the past developed in the riverside region and river water is still worshipped as Jagdish. He blamed water wastage and climate change for the declining in drinking water and groundwater. According to him, this type of capacity building program is very essential as various urban planners advise different types of framework for river restoration. In order to reduce river pollution and protect riverine ecosystem, he also said that the joint venture should be taken by NMCG and NIWA with the involvement of young generation. His advice really made our webinar glorious. Another of our special speaker, Dr. Tapoti Banerjee, said about the three sacred rivers of Barasat, namely Subarnagoti, Lavanyagoti, and Devganga. She highlighted how the pressure of urbanization has now turned these rivers into canals. Dr. Victor Shinde was our first speaker in the technical session. He spoke on the urban river management plan. He gave a clear idea about the causes of river pollution and how it can be strategically prevented through the urban river management plan. Our next speaker was Mr. Harpal Dave, who delivered his lecture on integrating rivers into urban planning framework. He gave a clear idea of the framework of how river can improve a city and facilitate its socio-economic development. In the end, the feedbacks that we received from the participants after the conclusion of yesterday's session, it was testimony of how successful the session was. And we are all looking forward to the second day of our webinar. So thank you all. Thank you very much. Over to you, Antara.
Thank you, sir. Now I would like to invite our chairperson, Dr. Bishwajit Roy Choudhury, to say a few words. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Antara, and thank you, Arindam, for your wonderful initiation. And yesterday, I have already told each and everything about our platform, but today I would like to be very honored to invite our special guest today, Sri Rajiv Ranjan Mishraji, IAS Officer or Honorable Director General of National Mission for Clean Ganga, Ministry of Jal Shakti, Government of India. Along with our another guest of honor, Mr. Hitesh Baituji, Director of National Institute of Urban Affairs, Government of India, Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, Government of India. Along with our resource persons, today's resource persons, Dr. Professor Kaushik Ghosh from Netaji Subhash Administrative Training Institute, Government of West Bengal. Along with Dr. Amit Hajela, sir, Professor and Director of Vastukala Academy, New Delhi. So for delivering a speech on this session. So yesterday, as I told that these type of capacity building programs from the very beginning of our institution, particularly SIURD, is looking forward for some specific areas where I think, or rather we think that it should be highlighted. And right now the urbanization sectors, along with the technology sectors, that is the geoinformatics, emerging technologies, and how it can be a part of that urban related studies and all that. And I think this type of activity, this type of areas, we have to focus, you know, and we have to bring in light in front of our students as that they can be able to know the opportunities and that they can be able to know the areas of interest, and they can find some interest on that. And particularly, not only that, there should be more and more proficiency in their research perspective. And as emerging emerging technologies, inclusive urbanism, inclusive urbanism related studies like green technology, mobility, smart technology, it's an everything is related. But the most important precious thing is the resource, and which we believe that resource is the only part, and among them the most important is the water resource. So that's why today we think that, as you know, that in most parts of the India, the rivers, most of the cities are located along both sides of the river Ganga. But that is the main, as we told, that river Ganga is the lifeline of our Indian civilization. So not only river Ganga, but almost all the rivers are the lifeline of our Indian civilization. So we have to think about it. We have to think about their health. We have to think about the ecosystems which has developed on both sides of the rivers. So that's why, according to that, our manners, according to that, our activity should be focused on that. And on the basis of the initiation of the ministry, that is the NMCG, and we came to know that there is a very good initiative has taken by both the ministry, that is the urban ministry and the NMCG also, for developing some specific activities and opportunities alongside the river areas. And for that, particularly riverine urban based area plan sectors has been developed. And that's why I'm really happy and really glad and honored that these kind of initiatives have taken by both the ministries. And as you know, that from the very beginning of our platform, from the very beginning of our CUBE Center, that is the Center for Urban and Built Environment, we have specifically named the 2 points as urban and built environment, because built environment is particularly denoting the word sustainable development. So if we go for the thing for the sustainability, then we have to think about the resources which we have. And for that, we have to focus on our water resources particularly. And on the basis of that water resources, we, according to that, we have to design our plan, we have to keep our activities, each and everything. So in this respect, this webinar is, I think, it's a really, really significant, particularly for the urban planners, particularly for the river scientists, particularly for the environment, the resource persons, all the researchers, those who are focusing to work on that particular issues. So in this respect, these 2 days discussion, hope it will be very much helpful for all of you. And even last but not least, our Honorable Union Cabinet Minister, Minister of Jal Shakti, Mr. Gajendra Singh Shekhawat ji, yesterday told very in a precise and very elaborate way that the significance of this riverine system and significance of this riverine ecosystem, particularly in case of urban sectors and for the development or for the sustenance of the humanity. So with this, I think this today's workshops also, today's part session also, where our eminent personalities have joined, those who are working particularly on that particular field and they have some hands-on experience. So that's why I think this session will definitely help bring some another inputs to all your minds and energize your thinking with their extensive lectures. So with this, once again, I would like to give my sincere thanks to all my team members, all the participants, along with those who have joined through our social media platforms also, and especially, not but least, our honorable guest today, Mr. Rajiv Ranjan Misra sir, Hitesh Vaidya sir, and Dr. Kaushik Ghosh and Dr. Amit Hajela sir for their honorable support. So thank you once again. Jai Hind, Vande Mataram.
Thank you, sir. Now it's time we cordially invite our special guest, Shri Rajiv Ranjan Misra, IAS Director General, National Mission for Clean Ganga, Ministry of Jal Shakti, Government of India. He is an officer belonging to the Indian Administrative Service. Mr. Rajiv Ranjan Misra is currently at the rank of Secretary in Government of India and working as Director General of National Mission for Clean Ganga. Since 2018, he has spearheaded Namami Ganges program and integrated river rejuvenation approach with multiple activities spanning joining 11 states of the Ganga River Basin and creating a model program for river rejuvenation in India. He has been responsible for various policy level interventions, including the ecological flow notification of 2018 and bringing to completion multiple projects for Aviralta and Nirmalta of River Ganga. He is making pioneering effort for developing a framework for planning for river cities by mainstreaming river and water into urban master plans. Presently, he is also in charge of National River Conservation Directorate, looking after rivers outside Ganga Basin. A mechanical engineer from IIT Kanpur, he has in the past looked after various departments at state level, such as irrigation, municipal administration and urban development, infrastructure and investments as secretary or principal secretary, and worked in development and regulatory positions at field level. He has attended many national and international level trainings or seminars on various subjects. He also has certificates in advanced studies in public administration from Maxwell School, Syracuse University, USA, public budgeting from Georgia State University, Atlanta, project management from University of California, Berkeley, and development program from Harvard Kennedy School, Cambridge, USA. I would kindly request to say a few words to you, sir. Shri Rajiv Ranjan Mishra, over to you, sir. Sir, Mr. Rajiv Ranjan Mishra.
Antara madam, sir is joining. He disconnected due to some network issue. He is joining.
Oh, sure, sir. Okay. No issue.
Okay, madam.
Yes, Mishra sir has joined.
Hello.
Hello,
sir. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. You're audible, sir. Perfectly audible.
Yeah. Okay. Right. No, there was some network problem, so I was doubtful. For a moment, I was out of the connectivity. Right.
No issue.
Good morning, everyone. It's really very, very, it's my pleasure to be with you. And first of all, I would really like to compliment the organizers, the Center for Urban and Built Environment, as well as CUBE under SIARD and also NIUA for thinking of this topic. And as we have discussed yesterday, and I was in a position to be with you to listen to some of the discussion yesterday, and Arindam ji has very briefly also summarized the points. I think we have our task cut out. As we know, civilization or society, we cannot survive without water. River is one very, very important source of water. And unless river is healthy, our civilization cannot remain healthy. So when we talk of rejuvenating a river or keeping a river healthy, primarily we have to look at rejuvenation of our society and rejuvenation of our civilization. And as we all know it quite well, that civilization growth started on the bank of river, or wherever there was no river, on the bank of a lake or any other big water body. But slowly what happens, we start developing and then city becomes start growing, and sometimes it becomes so big that a part of river starts getting lost. And if you look at some of the examples given by Dr. Banerjee yesterday about the three rivers in from Bengal, Suvarnavati, Lavanyavati and Devganga, and the way these rivers were, the way they were sacred, the way they were worshipped,
and the way their use had changed, the way their status had changed into a canal, or sometimes they become a nala, or a drain. So I think that reflects upon how, where we are going, and that's why perhaps there is a need to bring the two things together. And as our Honorable Minister yesterday told you quite a lot about Namami Gange program, so I won't get into details of what exactly is the program or what we are trying. But one major thing which we are all trying with the help of several stakeholders and several partners like you as well, is trying to bring a kind of holistic integrated perspective. And if you look at river rejuvenation, first of all, we changed from the past thinking was we started looking at the basin. So I think in the basin, you try to bring in all aspects of basin management, and then only perhaps River Ganga can be rejuvenated. So that's one. And then broadly, we started looking as it's a very common way to look at Nirmalta and Avirelta, Nirmal Ganga. So how we can avoid the pollution, how we can prevent the pollution from entering the river from different sources. So that's one. Ecology and flow. Unless we look at the long-term ecology of the river, its ecosystem, unless we look at improving flow, no river can be called a river unless there is a flow of water. So I think that becomes a very important thing, and we can put all of them as a kind of bit bracket of Aviral Ganga. And then we say that people are important. As I started saying that it's people who actually either make or break a river or make or break a water resource. So I think basically people river connect has to improve. And then to do all of them scientifically, to do all of them very nicely, we need to increase our knowledge. We need to do a study. We need to do R&D. And that's where perhaps the institutions like you and then the partners and the people who are present, they become very important. So we have to look at all of them. Now, looking at this perspective, at one level, we have to think about the integrated river basin management. So you look at 2,525 kilometers of Ganga, innumerable tributaries and sub-tributaries and streams, all of them constitute river. All of them constitute River Ganga. And please don't mind, I am telling more Ganga, more and more Ganga, but what we are talking today is equally relevant for any river in the country or in the world. So I think, and especially in the Indian context, basically Ganga represents all river. Ganga represents not only river, all water. And in 2016, we came up with an order, very briefly it was mentioned by Honorable Minister, the authority order for NMCG. And I can very honestly tell you that order, that notification under Environment Protection Act, for the first time tries to build in a kind of fundamental principles for river rejuvenation. And it talks few things which are very important for understanding a concept. It talks about managing Ganga as one system. And when we say one system, we mean, as I just explained, the major river, we mean tributaries, we mean sub-tributaries, they are small rivers. What's more important is we also mean the floodplain as part of the river. We also mean the wetlands along the river or in the basin. We mean springs. In the Himalayan area, you have springs, floodplains. So I think all of them constitute river. And then it also talks about continuity of river. And we have to basically look at continuity in terms of three things. One is the longitudinal continuity. So when we construct some structure across the river, certainly we affect the longitudinal connectivity. So that should be restored, or we should do something that there is some sort of movement of aquatic life or movement of water continuously. Then it talks of lateral connectivity. So we have to look at the lateral connectivity, means basically the floodplain. So the rivers would be given room to expand when the flood season comes, when the rainy season comes. And rivers would be in a position to contract, because that floodplain is basically land of the river. And then that has to be respected, because then only you will get recharge of your aquifers. And then the third is the vertical connectivity, and that is where we mean basically we have a tendency to look at surface water and groundwater in separate brackets. There can be separate specialization, but somewhere we have to integrate in our thinking. So actually in the river thing, we have to also look at how groundwater is recharged. And I think we all know that any river, the source of water is primarily two. Either it is a kind of Himalayan river, or you get some glacial melt, some water comes. But if you look at the entire length of Ganga, let's say in case of Bihar or Bengal stretch, perhaps the river is not getting so much of water contribution from the glacial melt than it is from the base flow of the groundwater. So I think that is something which becomes very important. And in basin level interaction or interventions are there, we are looking at different ways of doing it. But I won't go too much about the basin level interventions today, because today we are basically trying to understand the interaction, understand challenges between riverine ecosystem and urban system or urban planning. So I think coming back to the urban system, now if you look at Ganga, we enumerated under Namami Ganga, there are something like 100 towns. If you look at the basin, we have got almost like 500 urban local body towns and cities in the Ganga basin. Then if you look at certain missions, some numbers like Amrut mission, if you look at, we know that more than 1 lakh population cities are in Amrut cities, and 500 such cities are there. Around 300 of them are on the river. So I think in our mission in Namami Gange, with the help of other ministries, we are trying to develop a concept of river cities, how river cities should be planned. And we must do something more than what we do for urban planning. As we all understand, we are urbanizing. We are going to urbanize further in 2050. When you come, you are going to have more than 50% of India will live in cities or towns. How are we prepared? How are we prepared? And that's one hand of the load of urbanization. Second is our water stress. We are a kind of water stress country. Almost 600 million population in India is in some sort of water stress condition. World Bank estimated by 2050, the water shortage may lead to loss of 6% of our GDP. So I think these are all very, very alarming statistics. We have 18% of population, we have only 4% of global freshwater resources. So I think we have to wake up. And especially in context of Ganga Basin or the states which are on the main stem of Ganga, somehow people have a feeling that we have a lot of water. And that leads to a lot of excess use of water. So essentially, there are two major problems for any river system. One thing is the disproportionate or very high abstraction of water. Agriculture is one major area. But even the urban system, as we are going to urbanize, we will need more water for the for the cities. So I think that's also going to bring in more and more stress on the river system. And then other thing is pollution. Now, we try to look at the solution to, I mean, all these kind of solid and liquid waste which we keep on getting into the river. And we tried to bring in some sustainable solution, looking at the little long-term thing, and then we brought a concept of all our STPs should be not only constructed, should also be run by the same agency for 15 years. So we built in those kind of approach. But we also started thinking that, okay, 15 years, in the life of river, 15 years is nothing. I mean, we may feel 15 years is a long-term O&M contract we are giving, but for the life of a city or for the life of the river, I mean, we are talking of thousands of years, lakhs of years. So I think this is nothing. So what happens after 15 years? And that is where we started engaging with several stakeholders and different ministries for integrating it in the planning. Whether it is planning for ecological flow, whether it is planning for floodplain management, whether it is planning for urbanization. And there, I think yesterday, DCPO and NIUSI, you got two presentations. So we started developing a kind of concept of river cities, and then how we can mainstream river, mainstream water into master plans. And basically, we are working at two levels. One, I think you got to know about urban river management plan. And then the second thing is making master plans water sensitive, making master plans river sensitive. So we have taken up analysis of several master plans, and we tried to do it that how exactly they treat water, how exactly they treat river. And then when we are looking at that, we realize that perhaps it is not being given due importance. It's not being understood very nicely. And that's why we are trying to develop all these documents. And TCB also has come up with a river sensitive urban planning guidelines recently. So we are working together. And the trigger also came in 2019 in December when Honorable Prime Minister chaired the National Ganga Council meeting. And in fact, he very clearly articulated it very strongly, saying that the people living in the city must ask what we can do for the river. What is our contribution to keep the river healthy? Because we are getting all the what we can do for the river. I think that's what we should ask. And then he told us to look at these from keeping the two things together and just develop all these planning. And then we are moving ahead. The Delhi Master Plan, which is being now renewed, we have also tried to integrate it with Yamuna. Because Yamuna is in a very pathetic condition in Delhi. I told you ki sahar inhe bare ho jate hain ki nadiyan unme ko jati hain. And Delhi and Yamuna is the most appropriate example. Agar aap Delhi mein kahin jaake poochhein, most of the people do not know how to reach Yamuna. The only way they look at Yamuna is when they are traveling on the flyover and they see the polluted river below them, or when they are traveling by train, then they have a look at the Yamuna. Hardly anyone goes near the bank of Yamuna. Fortunately, in case of Ganga, we are in a much better situation. I think so that is something which is very, very important. So basically, we have to look at river and city, and we have to look at river and people. I think these are the three X, Y, Z axis. If you think, I think these three things are very important and we have to look at together. Now, I think we have to learn quite a lot from some of the international experience and also some experiences in our country. If you look at Denmark, I think recently I was looking at, they came to meet us also. See, they are actually quite abundant in water. But the role of policies would be such, I think we have to actually intervene at the policy level, and we are trying. They try to minimize the water loss. 95% of the wastewater is recovered and treated, 95%. I will come to Indian situation and we'll know how much challenge is there. And much of it is reused. Singapore, again, Singapore is a smaller country, but they go to the best possible reuse for everything. And then they, not only that, they also want to become climate neutral by 2030. So I think the way they work, that all these things would come. Whereas we have roughly 72,000 MLD of sewage generation throughout country. I'm not talking of Ganga, I'm talking of entire country. We treat roughly around 32,000 MLD. 44% of this water is treated. It used to be earlier only one third. Now it has increased in with previous efforts. So almost about 10%. But again, what we treat, all of it is not of acceptable standard. So we still have a gap. Even we say we are treating 44%, there is still a gap of something like 10%, which is we are not able to treat to the required standard. So we have to further work there. Reuse, a lot of progress has been made, but still we are nowhere compared to some of the countries there. So I think we have a long way to go there. And this becomes important because most of it is from the urban system. I mean, that's where we have to look at. But we also have some excellent examples in our country. The reuse, Chennai, if you look at Chennai and Surat, two cities I will tell you, where they have really gone for very good models for reuse of treated wastewater. In fact, Surat is making a lot of revenue out of this reuse. So what is important is we are trying to insist that a state should come up with a state policy for reuse of treated wastewater. And Tamil Nadu, Gujarat, Maharashtra, several states are coming. In Ganga Basin also, some states like Haryana, and then all the states are working on developing it. We also got several, urban missions, whether it's Amrit or Jal Jeevan, the Ganga Mission, NRCP, several missions have been launched. And then water as a kind of sector has been given a lot of importance in the last few years. And perhaps this is a very good opportunity to meet the kind of challenges which we have got. But again, I mean, I gave you an example of Denmark. Look at Netherlands. I think we all are knowing, I mean, we are all very much used to floods in Bengal and Bihar every year. UP also had a lot of flood. For the first time, severe flood was seen in European countries, the Netherlands, Luxembourg, Germany. I think half of the citizens in those countries where we never thought that such kind of flood will come in Europe, they thought that it's basically the characteristic of Asian countries, but we also have so much of flood. Of course, climate change, and then that's a very important thing. But you see the response of Netherlands. Now, Netherlands have actually, through a policy, through thinking, they have internalized river thinking in their urban planning. And primarily, they have a concept of living with the river. What perhaps we can learn from them, that we have to live with the river. And we knew it. Our traditional community and earlier days, we were very much aware about, we have to live with the river, we have to build with the nature. So that's why your Center for Built Environment, Urban and Built Environment, when I think, when we think of built environment, we have to build with nature. And we have to give room for the river. And if we do this, perhaps the damage due to flood, and very cautious, because as climate change impact becomes more and more pronounced, and it's going to be pronounced in future, I think these are the thinking, these are the processes which will actually help us in doing that. Now, coming back to our project, and more importantly, let's look at the Bengal. Let's look at the Ganga in Bengal, and then the, let's say, southern part of Ganga before it meets Bay of Bengal. We have got something like more than 30 urban local bodies very close to each other in a cluster. So I think you don't know where one municipality is getting over and another is starting. So I think this is a very, very unique kind of situation we will look at. So whether we look at the master plan or whether we look at the urban river management plan, NIUA, it's IARD also. So I think we have to look at this as a kind of cluster of urban local bodies and look at the urban planning in maybe two or three clusters for these 30 urban local bodies and look at how we can integrate it. Yesterday, we got the example of three rivers from Bengal which are lost from its. There are several examples all over country if we see, and all over Ganga if we see. And several times the development process does not factor into that. Looking little more closely about the Bengal, I think it's a very uniquely placed state where perhaps you have got hill area and sea. And you have several small streams, several small rivers, which needs to be mapped very, very accurately. And not only mapped in their present situation, perhaps some historically we have that how many rivers are lost. How many rivers we have lost in our country in different states. And look at, can we do something to revive them? And we are trying to now, after working on the main stem and some of the major tributaries, our priority is to take the cause of a small rivers. Because ultimately, these are small rivers, somewhere in some book I was reading, they use the term stolen rivers. Who has stolen? We all have stolen these rivers. So I think in the landscape, in the natural landscape, the rivers used to be there by our agriculture, encroaching for agriculture or encroaching for urbanization, we have removed them. So I think we have to look at these stolen rivers and then see that can we give it back to its rightful owner, which was the environment, which was nature. So I think that we have to look at, we very well know the Tolis Nala, because we are also working, we call it Toli Nala. It was Adi Ganga. So I think there are several examples I can keep on endlessly telling you, but what is the option before us? We have to change our thinking and change the policy. Then if we agree to do that, we have enough expertise, we have enough intellectual potential to work together to develop a kind of model for master plan, which becomes river sensitive. We develop a kind of integrated urban water management, look at storm water, look at groundwater, look at aquifers, look at wastewater in an integrated manner. Can we use this rainwater? Because rainwater is the only source now. Even if it's becoming erratic, that's the only source of water. We have to utilize it. We have to use it for recharging groundwater. We have to use it for recharging our aquifers. Do some of the reuse of the treated wastewater. I mean, and for the fit for use purpose, develop a standard. I think several things we have to do it. And then how we do it, cities are blamed for the bad state of rivers. The challenge is, can we all put together, change this image? Can cities become positive for the basin health? It's not a very easy task, but perhaps this has to be done. And there is no other option before us but to do it. So primarily we have to look at how the cities can start looking at biodiversity of the city, the catchment area, the riverfront. See, the riverfronts are perhaps the best public place you can find in a city if you maintain it clean, if you maintain it, if you revive it. So what kind of riverfront we want for our city? How we can develop water sensitive communities in the city also. The people also must start changing their behavior and start doing it. Can cities be developed as a water supply catchment? I'm talking something which is absolutely not there in present situation, but can we go to that? And then it's possible only when we collaborate. And that's why you see this today's topic is really very, very close to my heart, because we are trying to integrate, and we have been personally, we have been trying to take this cause, and with the able support from NIUA, from SIARD, we also have good support from Center for Science and Environment, CSE, which is working with us for capacity building of urban local body. So I think collaboration and capacity building, these two are very, and communication. These three things will be very, very important, and such kind of program really give us a kind of chance to do that, because we have to collaborate for multi-sectoral interventions, whether it is river water, groundwater, rainwater, in the city, adjoining to the city, because as you know, cities are also, their boundaries are also very diffuse. Today we have a municipal limit, tomorrow some villages are added in the municipal limit. So you have got some suburban area, they develop city characteristic, you have peri-urban area or development authority area, they also have city characteristic. And you have to plan in such a way that you basically look at a kind of region, because sooner or later, if you look at 2050, when 50% of population is in urban areas, all these things which you see as village or a small town, they are all going to have absolutely urban characteristics. So how we are planning to them? What is going to happen to the water bodies? Because what happens, I mean, unfortunately, we kill our own local sources of water, local water bodies, and we start transporting water, because you know, we have technology. So I think we have, if someone gives us money and we have engineering skills, so I think we go for the structured solutions. So I will give an example in Agra, which is on the bank of Yamuna. We are transporting water from Ganga, and Ganga water is going to Yamuna, because Yamuna in Agra is really in a very bad condition. So I think that kind of situation we have to avoid, because now we are able to do it, in future we will not be able to do it. Things will become so difficult. And that's why urban planning and riverine ecosystem have to be thought together, have to be planned together, have to be acted upon together by all the people who have a responsibility to do it. And the most of all, the citizens are also going to be responsible for it. And this kind of training program, this kind of workshop, this kind of roundtable brainstorming session is very important, because we get to reach out to different people. We reach out to different stakeholders, and on, as I told you, we have to work for Nirmalta, we have to work for Abiralta, we have to bring it in a kind of Janaganga, and all these things will get nourished, all of them will get reinforced with improved knowledge, as we have been trying to build through collaborative network of partner institutions. I look forward to carrying forward this exercise in future with the help of all of you. I once again compliment the organizers for very ably supporting us, and I look forward to CUBE as well as SIARD to become a partner in this journey, and then at least wherever you have strength, carry forward this message. We can have some programs together. NIUA is also here, so with NIUA, with you, with me, and then there will be several partners who will join, because that's the only way to look at this kind of massive target before us. So once again, best wishes to everyone, and let's all envision a very, very healthy river and a very, very developed eco-friendly cities and its citizens. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for accentuating the idea of restoration, river ecosystem and urban plan by sharing your thoughts through your experience and examples from India and from all over the world in such short of span of time with us. Thank you.
Antara, just a minute. I am interested.
Yes. Yes.
Sir, yes, there is a question from my side. Okay, and as you said, you said that collaborative work is always highly required for any kind of management program. So, sir, if we want to do any kind of program related with riverine ecosystem or riverine management, that how NMCG will help us or will cooperate with us?
See, I think as I told you, we can work together for capacity building programs. And as I told you, you are located in Kolkata, and if you want to take up like this, there are several cities, several towns on the river. And I told Ganga, but I think there are several tributaries. There also you have got several cities and this thing. So we can perhaps look at what kind of survey of the planning exercise, what kind of master plans are there. So I think some studies could be taken up together, number one. And NIUA is already doing a major project for us. It would be a kind of tripartite collaboration as well. We can always think of organizing good capacity programs for them, for these urban local bodies. And those kind of training programs could be thought of, conceptualized, and we can look at that. And for other local institutions, we can organize some of these things. I will tell you, we have also taken up one exercise of surveying the water bodies all along Ganga in different states through the Quality Council of India. And I think that's something a little positive news for Bengal. They said that the water body, that's in the rural area I'm talking, the water bodies or the talao, pokhara, what we call in Bengal, are in a better condition than what it is in UP and other places, because this is very important. The livelihood is linked with these pokhras in the villages, because they are basically used as fish pond. So people eat fish, the people and then it's also a question of their livelihood. So even that kind of exercise also we can look at, that what are the livelihood opportunities, the communities on the riverbank, what are their livelihood, what is that pattern, how we can improve, understand that, and also help them so that the river conservation and livelihood is linked. Sometimes this livelihood also, I think there is no limit to greed. So we kill the river itself, from which you are getting a lot of these things. And you know, I think there is a lot of protest came from some of these communities in Bengal also, where they tried to protect the fish pond, because sometimes for construction and other things, these things are also damaged. So I think that there are several areas where we can perhaps put our mind together and work out to develop some programs together.
Okay, sir. Thank you. So in this regard, I want to inform you that, sir, we already selected an area, and we already are planning for the integrated river management program, where the livelihood development part is also an essential part of this program. And this portion, I mean, this case study is related to the North 24 Parganas in our West Bengal. But we are already in planning, and we are making this plan that how this type of initiative can be implemented through our SIAD in collaboration with NMCG. So this is already in our process, sir. And I want to inform you that after this completion of our project planning, we all want to submit this proposal to you also.
Okay, thank you. We'll certainly look forward. Just before I leave or I close, you talked about some of things, because several people are in present there. See, the reverse science as a subject of knowledge, subject of study, needs to develop. Because we have hydrology, we have ecology, we have got morphology, and there are different branches and you have expert on that. But river rejuvenation, I mean, we need to really develop an understanding of the river. River is not simply the water which is flowing from one place to another place. River is so many things. As Minister also highlighted, river is not only meant for human being, I mean, it's meant for so many things. So I think perhaps there is need, and we are trying to work with some of the institutions to really bring some sort of preliminary course, orientation program, river rejuvenation, river science, and then it would be a kind of series of courses. So I think these are some of the things where perhaps you can start thinking, and then we can develop some modules, we can develop some of these things in future. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Definitely. Thank you, sir. Antara, please.
Yes, sir. I think Bishwajit sir has raised his hands. I guess he has something to say. Yes, sir.
Sir, am I audible?
Yes.
Yes.
Sir, first of all, wonderful. Thank you once again for your wonderful lecture. And today, whatever you have delivered, definitely Arindam and told also, okay, we are also planning for some different area livelihood development plan, though in a smaller part, but in a larger section of people are associated with that area. Along with that, on behalf of our SIAD, we have taken another initiative for awareness generation and livelihood development sectors also. So in this regard, we are connected with the several NGOs, those who are college and university professors from the different universities and colleges. And we are going to organize a 2 days awareness camp on the riverine side area and also the livelihood development, along with the inclusion of the school students and the local people, local class. And besides that, I'd like to inform another news to you that on behalf of our SIAD, we develop not only capacity building modules, but also several course modules, which is all right now in the mainstream world. There is a river courses, hydrology based courses, but there is no river specific courses. So we launched some courses on certificate and PG diploma mode, that is the river science, river sectors related, so even river geoinformatics also. So wherever the course module, we have drafted the course modules initially, but wherever we will prepare, I will request you also, I will send to the NMCG, and also I will be happy if your organization will also be a part for the curriculum with the internship of our students, even some orientation programs, preparation courses. We are also planning for all that particular field and related to the urban ecosystem, like that sectors. So in this regard, I will also hopefully NMCG is always you sharing your cooperative hands with us. We can also
get some. Your enthusiasm, we will certainly move together.
Thank you, sir. So I hope after Tapati Vanerji ma'am has joined today, director of National Atlas and Thematic So she was to yesterday. She has focused some points on the paleochannel sectors in West Bengal. So, ma'am, are you here? Please, I will be happy if you kindly share those points to Rajiv sir.
Namaskar, sir. Namaskar.
Good day. Namaste. Happy to be here. Namaste. 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 I was quite. Your presentation was really very interesting. I read quite a lot about West Bengal rivers. You motivated me to do a little more research on that, and I see immense potential to do mapping of them.
Yes. Actually, sir, in continuation of your deliberation, what you are talking about river science, I think Bishwajit will agree with me. There was a discipline by a specialization in geography subject, that is fluvial geomorphology. It was there. I hope still it is there here.
Yes.
And regarding this river examination and other things, I just yesterday I talked about three rivers, these decaying rivers in my area. Still, there are some places, urban areas in Hooghly district and others,
yes,
that the reducing nature or decaying nature of Saraswati River. I think last year also there was a news that several small ship has been discovered in that while digging the sands in that river bank area. So this is the regular happenings in the different channel area, river area, because these are the rivers which were used for international trading. And that has been decayed and almost in decaying in nature. So being another thing is that this lower Gangetic plain, especially in West Bengal area, because of its meandering nature and sluggish flowing nature, this river usually has had a tendency to shift. So whenever there is a shifting of river, this river part, this becomes a paleo channel, and several water bodies have been formed out of that. And now these water bodies, especially in that Kollani area, it's a northern part of West Bengal.
क्या तो पूछो कहाँ है
So, sir, these water bodies are now because of this population crowd or population pressure. Now, these water bodies also are maintaining the ecosystem. Now, these are going to disbalance due to their occupants by the urban occupancy because of their urban occupancy. One more thing is that in East Calcutta metropolitan area, there is a wetland that is under Ramsar Convention, Convention area. And what is the thing that this area is also now occupied by the vicious circle, due to urban encroachment. So these are the things we should take care immediately, because this is the, I think, as that NMCG and Ministry of Jal Shakti and Urban Development, Urban Department, they are taking that initiative. This is the right time to take the initiative immediately in order to worse the condition. Before that, you should take the initiative. This is the high time to take the initiative. And I think Vishwajit, the initiative he has taken in support of these two departments, I think if we can prepare one atlas type or resource planning maps to rejuvenate as well as to maintain these urban rivers, especially now in Calcutta, in the recent the raining, this year raining is much higher, the number of rainy days are more, and that amount of rainfall is quite large this year. So I think this situation in Calcutta and the surrounding areas is going to worse than last 2 years or two to 5 years. So immediately we need to rejuvenate all these canals and rivers, along with, I think, not only rivers, related canals are also to be rejuvenated. So if they can, if they take the initiative to prepare any kind of resource planning map to visualize what are the things happening and what are the areas where the government can take initiative, if they prepare this type of resource information system, I think it will be very useful for the development planning, for the taking that initiative for the developmental planning. I think it will be very helpful, and this is the right time to take the initiative. With this, I thank you, sir.
Absolutely, you are absolutely right. And then we have to do a mapping. And as you said, there are several subjects in different specialization. But ultimately, we must do this mapping, and we must restore the identity of each river. You know, river is not just a kind of water body or a kind of channel and all that. There are certain values, there are certain folklores, there are certain stories related with all these rivers. I went to Saharanpur the other day, and then there is a small river, Paundhoi. Not many people know outside, but people do some worship there in that Paundhoi river also, and we are trying to rejuvenate. So I think when I say river science, understanding the river in totality, I think all the things we have to put together, and then... And that will help you in connecting people back with the cause. I think some of these heritage, some of these old values will also drive. And you talked about urban rivers, most of them will be polluted. NGT, the Honorable Green Tribunal, is also monitoring them. And recently, one judgment, I will just very quickly tell. In that judgment, they said that it's not that only Western countries respect the river. I gave you some examples of Denmark and Netherlands. And it actually, the NGT order, which came in a few days back, quotes from some of our scriptures and old cultural things where the rivers were supposed to be worshipped. What minister also said yesterday, this is part of the order of the NGT. It was trying to say the traditional wisdom. And many people, the communities, knew how to live with the river, but slowly with all other kind of, especially from British period, lot of different types of road network, railway network came. That also changed the way we are looking at the river. Culverts came. And often we are only looking at a very quick engineering solution without its long-term thing. So I think we should certainly work together. We'll be very happy to spend a little longer time and deliberate and take up a kind of mapping of these rivers. And then we can perhaps take up in the lower Gangetic plain these kind of things, because not much is being talked about them now in the latest thing. So I think this is very good opportunity for the right partners to come together and do it.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. I think there's a question raised in the chat box. Actually, not a question. Mr. Shafat Rashid, he has said that, I think due unplanned horizontal urban expansion and lack of management and planning, the ecosystem of the existing water bodies are deteriorating and getting vanished from the atlas. If there is any opinion on that, you can share that.
Yes, please continue.
I couldn't somehow hear this properly, so.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Dapati Banerjee, and thank you, sir. So, well,
actually what he was asking about this vanishing of from the atlas, it's not like that. Actually, updation is not going on. Sporadically, that type of work is going on. And recently, we have worked, our internship student, they have worked on that that East Calcutta wetland. And there also we have, just now I have informed that encroachment of high-rise building in that Ramsar Convention area and that wetland, because, but we could not publish it because there will be several controversies regarding this and the information we are having. And as that during the time of updation of this atlas, I think it will be published during the time of atlas. At least information and everything is here with us. We will, and that in due course of time, we will show in our atlas.
I think I will just very, very quickly, I will add to this. I understood. We have a lot of technology now to do some of this mapping and show them properly. So I think one thing is, our atlas or mapping has to be accurate, and we have to look at that. And that order of entity I told you, it was in the case of Bangalore, and actually it was basically encroaching some sort of wetland only, and where they have ordered now to demolish that high-rise building. So I think these things are happening. We are all aware. East Kolkata wetland is a great asset for the city, because that is treating more than 500 MLD of wastewater of the Kolkata area. So I think without constructing an STP, which would have cost hundreds of crores, this is serving a huge this thing. But if we do too much of construction there, then naturally its capacity will also get eroded. And then West Bengal government also has come up with a plan for rejuvenation or doing some study of East Kolkata wetland, and it has gone to MOEF, and also a copy has come to us. So we are also trying to do something on that to help them. So I think the point is built again. We have to really map all these kind of things also, and then bring to the notice of the government.
Thank you, sir. I hope Mr. Shafat Rashid has got his answer, whatever was the query he was asking. I think he has got the answer. Now it's time. This is going to be a very precious moment for all of us. For that, I'd like to invite our chairperson, Dr. Vishwajit Raj Chaudhary, to announce something. Over to you, sir.
So thank you once again, Rajiv sir, Rajiv Ranjan Mishra sir, for your valuable and wonderful lecture, as always you have done. And this is our honor today. Also today, this is our honor on behalf of SIERT, that you have done a lots of work within your department whenever it has started journey. And this department has started very short term way, but has done a very multiple and long term activities, and whatever you have done, it's really, really marvelous. So that's why we, on behalf of SIERT, it's just a token of appreciation and gratitude to you that we are going to provide you our honorary fellow membership award. So I will be much happy, and our team will be very much happy and excited that if you kindly accept this honor on behalf of our institution. And hopefully your suggestions, your guidance will definitely help us in future for the development and for the activities which we can do on behalf of the River Urban Research. So.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Dr. Biswajit. I am humbled, and then perhaps it's a very nice question on the part of the institute. And I am always with you, and then I mean, we are all not with each other, we are together. So I think that is the spirit with which we have to work in this
thank you so much.
So once again, thank you so much. I am really grateful for this kind of gesture from your side. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And Antara, Ritesh sir, due to some technical issues, he will not be able to join right now, but he is trying to join within a minute. But he already suggested me to continue our technical sessions, and within the time schedule, he will join. He is trying, actually. So you please go for it. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Sure, sir. So then we have actually come to the end of the inaugural session. But before that, I must mention our deepest sense of appreciation to a special guest, Sri Rajiv Ranjan Mishra. Sir, you have taken out your precious time and joined us today. It was our honor, and we are privileged and blessed that you have joined us today. Thank you so much for joining us. So it's time we end our inaugural session and start our technical session. But before that, I am concluding my part for the time being here, inviting and giving the responsibility to Mrs. Munmun Chen, faculty of IIGST, to guide us. Let us all have an enjoyable technical session. Thank you all. Over to you, Munmun ma'am.
Thank you so much, Antara. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, Antara, for giving me the opportunity. So very good afternoon to our honorable guest, Sri Rajiv Ranjan Mishra, Director General, Ministry of Jal Shakti. And good afternoon to all the participants. And today we reach at our next part of our today's session, where we have speakers, Professor Kaushik Ghosh and Professor Amit Hajela. As a first speaker, I would like to welcome Professor Kaushik Ghosh. About Professor Kaushik Ghosh, I would like to say that he is a qualified architect and urban designer from Jadavpur University, Kolkata. Thereafter, he studied integrated urban planning from Blekinge Institute of Technology, Sweden. He has over 16 years works experience in the urban space, especially on urban planning, liquid and solid waste management, and sustainable development. He is presently working as assistant professor, Urban Management Centers, Netaji Subhash Administrative Training Institute, Government of West Bengal. In his present position, he has designed and conducted more than 300 capacity building programs as course director for municipal functionaries of West Bengal, Tamil Nadu, and Assam. He has also led research on slums, street vendors, affordable housing, and wastewater management. Among other capacities, as trainer, he is recognized master trainer and resource person on disaster risk reduction and septic management. He has guided Jodhpur Development Authority to formulate the DRR master plan for Jodhpur on behalf of the Lal Bahadur Shastri Academy of Administration, Mussoorie. Earlier, as urban planner, he formulated two consecutive five-year development plans for Noihati municipality. As resource planner, he guided development plan preparation of eight other municipalities of West Bengal. As techno-managerial consultant, he was involved in preparation of comprehensive rejuvenation plan of Ravindra Sarovar Lake under the National Lake Conservation Plan, Government of India, preparation of the pollution abatement scheme, city sanitation plan, and feasibility report of Bali municipality under the National Ganga Basin Authority, Government of India, preparation of the water supply scheme for Madhyamgram municipality, preparation of GIS based water supply managed plan for Kursiang municipality. He has participated and presented in different international forums
forums, and the list, I can say, have more works listed in his participation. But we are eagerly want to hear from you, sir. So I would like to welcome again Professor Kaushik Ghosh. So over to you, sir, as a first presenter.
Thank you very much. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. So I thank Dr. Biswajit Roy Choudhury and his wonderful team at SciArt. I have been listening to your efforts for the last 2 days, and it is really commendable. And I thank NIUA, especially the URMP program they have come up with is one of its kind, and I think it will go a long way in making an impact. And I thank even NMCG and Mishra sir for his wonderful deliberation and the great work he is doing. We are really inspired by you, sir, every day. And we take a lot of learnings from whatever you are doing here. With that, I will share my presentation. Just a minute. Am I visible?
Yes, sir, the presentation is visible.
And audible too, right?
Yeah, yes.
Thank you. So I guess I have 20 minutes time allotted, right?
Yes, sir. It can extend, yeah, sir, for 5 minutes.
No, I will be fast. So okay, my topic is on natural interventions and urban river rejuvenation. I decided on this topic today given the trend of this seminar and webinar. And by this, I mean is that there are always two sides to any phenomena. There is a long term and there is a short term. And especially this goes very well for planning. Since I have been involved in 5-year plans, I have seen that by the time you end up doing the 5-year plans, a lot of time has passed and the clock is ticking. And there is no time to waste actually. So both the planning and the little interventions must go hand in hand. So URMP, the NIUA and NMCG is doing a fantastic work in putting forth integrated urban planning for the entire river basin, river stretch. In the meantime, through standalone efforts or projects, there have been some commendable short-term interventions. So I'll share a few case studies also that what had been possible so far, and maybe that can be integrated into the bigger picture over a period of time. So the conceptual approach that was taken, I'll be sharing, is initially we find that urban development, all urban development, it began next to some sort of water body. And then what the story happened was, after centuries of expansion, the urban water bodies degraded into cesspools of sewage. I mean, the urban water bodies were the first casualties of development, although they were the very source from which the urban development started. And the picture somehow seems like this, or rivers which are not yet like this may have the potential to become like this if this trend continues. So what do we see in this picture? That industrial wastewater has somehow polluted the entire water body so much that, forget the water quality, it is literally foaming on the top. So is the situation where a large population, especially in the Gangetic River Belt, uses the river for their daily activities, bathing, washing, and that is polluted beyond measure with all kinds of debris. Now, what is the problem out here? The general statistics show that 330 cubic kilometer of municipal wastewater, 330 cubic kilometer, it is generated worldwide. So it is not an India-centric phenomenon. It is happening all over the world only. And 80% of it is wastewater, which is being dumped in the lakes, rivers, and underground. The National Green Tribunal also gives us very alarming figures that 351 river stretches out of 323 rivers are very polluted in India. Now, based on the different kind of water bodies we have here, what we have classified the water body into urban wetlands and ponds. We have constructed basins, ponds, wetlands, biofilters, then urban streams are there, urban rivers are there. Flooding is also a phenomena which is another form of urban stream. And then there are urban coastal zones. Now, these are the differences that has helped us, depending on the flow, depending on the size, to discriminate the different water bodies. But there is one common point which is very, very similar to all the water bodies, and that is, it is the final outfall. It is the final outfall for all kinds of wastewater, both treated and untreated, in the sanitation chain. And if we look at the sanitation chain, we see that we have been planning, and NIUA again is doing a commendable work there through the SCVP program, where they have, and the Swachh Bharat Mission is also gearing up in this respect, where the toilet access, the collection, the transportation, everything is happening in a better way than before. But again, the treatment and the disposal is a gray area. And ultimately, the river takes the entire shock of the treatment and disposal. Two areas that we must be particularly prioritize is fecal sludge and septage. Among all the wastewater streams, you will find that fecal sludge has been a very neglected area, which was rightly addressed in the Amrut Mission, that we need to do something about it. Most of the urban areas do not have sewerage systems. They use septic tanks and soak pits. And somewhere this waste gets dumped unorganized way. And you can see in this picture that this is usually the picture where the solid waste management grounds, or somebody just dumps it over the bridge into some canal, and the water body gets the entire shock. Fecal sludge is having very high concentration of waste and bacterial matter, and hence it is of great concern compared to the sewerage that drains out, which is pretty diluted. Now, this is one picture that looks like a canal, but it is not a canal carrying ordinary wastewater or stormwater runoff. Canals are meant to carry the stormwater runoffs, but this is pure leachate. It is juice coming out from the solid waste management grounds, and that flows through the heart of the city like a canal. Whenever there is flooding, urban flooding, and overflow of the canal, just imagine the situation where this flows into the different households, and people are waiting for the daily activities through this kind of black water. And this is full of hard, heavy metals as well, and contaminated waste. So to summarize, we can find that the different wastewater streams are stormwater. Then we have domestic wastewater, which we all know about, hence I did not elaborate. We have industrial wastewater. We have leachate from solid waste dumping sites that I showed right now. And we have indiscriminate sewage septage dumping. Now, septage dumping is a great concern, as you have seen in the picture. But the story does not end here. If we are talking about rejuvenating rivers, why am I talking about the wastewater management? It is because the rivers exist, they don't exist on a standalone basis. They are continuously poured upon by the different tributaries, which are the canals and the drains. So unless and until we address the canals and the drains and the river basins, which all the national programs are trying to address, and rightly so, we cannot expect a clean river. And by river, it also does not mean that the beautification of the river bank only. That is what mostly happens in this kind of projects. But it is the river quality that is going to ultimately maintain the river. Another important part, which is much neglected but has great contribution in this pollution of the river, is the soil stabilization. For example, when agricultural fields drain into canals along with the fertilizers and the pesticides, it is a non-point source of pollution. In urban areas, it is still comparatively easier to manage if you are to address a drain falling into a river or any other point source of pollution. But in a non-point source of pollution, there are hardly any checks and balance, and they ultimately contaminate the entire stretch of the canals and the rivers. So that can be arrested if the embankments are adequately protected through some means. Then there is increased runoff during urbanization, because with urbanization comes deforestation, and more trees, when they are gone, especially in the hilly areas, the water tends to flow at a faster pace, bringing down the entire load of the soil with it. And unless this is addressed, the gradual siltation of the river channels will be very fast. And as I was talking about, the unstable embankments, which we constantly see during extreme flood events, which has increased over the past few years, and large chunks of land are just eroded. And the embankments, in spite of the engineering interventions every year, they still get eaten away. And it is adding to the siltation. Loss of life and property is inevitable in this case situation. And then there are solid waste dumps. Solid waste dumps contribute to a large way in deteriorating the environmental quality. And that's why it needs to be addressed in a faster manner, because all urban areas are facing this kind of situation. Fly ash dump may not be a very urban phenomenon, but it has far-reaching impacts. For example, a fly ash dump site, unless stabilized, it will carry this fly ash through the wind far away into the agricultural fields, thereby killing crops and also leading to respiratory issues for people living nearby, and if especially so for urban areas. This is same true for solid waste dump, because as the regulations say that it has to be minimum 6 kilometers away from the urban habitat. But in urban areas, we all know that it is always not possible. And the dumps are right there in the middle of the city. And people living in the surrounding vicinity do develop respiratory issues. Now, the intervention concept, what we had thought of was that to a large extent, if we are to address the river rejuvenation issue, we have to address the wastewater management issue and the soil stabilization issue that I summarized before. Now, we have seen that in a linear relationship where the humans use the water and make it into wastewater, the wastewater in turn is given back to the human and the health of the humans are affected. So in a linear relationship, there is very much lack of harmony. But what we have seen from nature, if we have learned from nature, that once we introduced a third element like the plants, which have been here much, much before than we have been here in this earth, and I believe that they are way ahead in the evolution process. So they take our carbon dioxide and convert it into oxygen, give it back to us for better breathing. Similarly, if used in case of water, where plants and microorganisms, they have this ability to restore the water quality and also keep it in a very good condition. So the plants and microorganisms have been largely used as a concept in the kind of interventions in the projects that I'm about to share with you. So what are the different areas or key interventions? It is the natural bioengineering process. And here, some sort of engineering is required for structural reasons mainly. And then the ability of the microorganisms to degrade the contaminants and the water pollutants through bioremediation. All of you must be aware of this. It is a very common concept nowadays. But how it is used is what the challenge is. Then there is phytoremediation, where the plants are used through some their special unique characteristics to help remediate the water. And then there is phytosoil stabilization. I will elaborate shortly. The areas of intervention have been the restoration of contaminated water bodies, lakes and canals, then river pollution management and riverfront development, canal and river embankment, slope protection and stabilization, then dump site pollution management and stabilization, solid waste dump site, green capping and land recovery. Green capping is very much essential if the legacy waste cannot be treated after a certain point of time. Many municipalities have come up with these tenders to treat the legacy waste, but you will find that in reality, there are not many takers because the legacy waste do not carry much value as a revenue generating means. So it makes sense, and it has happened rightly so in Kolkata as well, that some of these mounds have been kept with greenery and the land has been recovered for recreational purpose. Now the question arises, which plant to use? There are many plants which are suitable for environmental protection and restoration, like Arundodonax, Canna indica. These are very commonly seen plants. These are wetland plants, many of them. Alocasia, then lemongrass, hyacinth, vitellia, vetiver, many of them. Now, we have been studying these plants, and through the various literature and our personal experiences, we found out that one plant is very unique, and it is unique in many ways, which I will share right now. It is the vetiver, which has been renamed as Chrysopogon zizanoides, the scientific name. And they are having unique characteristics for soil and water conservation. As you can see in this root system, it develops a very dense root system, and it is deep penetrating and has massive fibrous roots, and it is erect and it can form a dense hedge. Thereby, it retards the speed of water if it is used on an embankment, and thereby it reduces its erosive power. It is a very tolerant plant. A plant that cannot survive under different conditions is not a suitable plant, because we are always not aware of what is the soil condition in that area. So this plant has great resistance to alkaline, acidic, saline, and even sodic environments. And it has ability to withstand prolonged submergence, which is also a very important criteria in a place like Bengal, where we occasionally witness inundation and floods. Then it has ability to adapt to wide range of climatic conditions. For example, in temperate climates, in tropical climates, in subtropical climates, this has been experimentally found out to be a very suitable area, and also in coastal areas. And it is easy to vegetatively multiply this vetiver. We have all heard of vetiver application in many places, but what I'm going to share is a particular type of bioengineering intervention through vetiver being one of the elements. Another great quality of this plant is it is sterile. It does not become a weed, like we have seen in the case of hyacinth, also is a weed imported from another country, and so is parthenium. So it is an invasive species which takes over the entire vegetation. But in this case, we are safe because vetiver is not an invasive species. And the best part is that it is readily available. Worldwide, there are mostly three types of vetiver that are used. It is vetiver zizanoides, vetiver nemoralis, and vetiver nigritana. So the nigritana is the African variant of the vetiver, and the nemoralis originates from Vietnam. But the vetiver or the Chrysopogon zizanoides is native to South India. And this South Indian variety has been experimentally proven worldwide to be the best performing one, and hence we chose it over other plants and other vetiver species as well. Urban wastewater management, I will share a few projects where this has been implemented and has given results. So basically, the raw materials used in these projects are very simple. It is coir and jute geotextiles, then geologs, as you can see here, made from the coir and jute, and then biomass is there, bamboo pegs to just hold it in position. Then beneficially microbes are used because it is an intervention comprising of bioremediation and phytoremediation. And then we have the plants. So the first project was done in 2017 at the Rishta Water Body Eco Restoration Project. It was a CSR project where Jayashree Textiles participated, and it is part of the Aditya Birla Grazing Group. And as you can see that this water body is located next to the railway station. The land is owned by the Eastern Railway only, but it has been dumped upon by the neighboring communities and the market lying out here. And it was in utter neglect, as you can see here. When the municipality and the Eastern Railway and the grazing group came up with this project, active community participation and enthusiasm was there. This project was implemented by a company called Symbio Green Tech under the leadership of Mr. Pradeep Kumar, who is a biotechnologist and who has been very instrumental in implementing such projects with his knowledge. I had been associated in this project in the planning and documentation capacity and advising mostly, but his main implementation has been done by him on the ground. So I'll share these case studies. So the local community came up with great enthusiasm in this participation and awareness project. And the restoration started with the help of local people only. So the restoration channels were restored. The local population was taught because the technology was simple. However, the intervention, the mix of bioremediation and phytoremediation, how much to give and how much to hold, is what is the real challenge, depending on the water quality. Then small floating gardens or rafts were used because this is the hydroponic intervention. This plant, the vetiver plant, has the ability to perform equally well in hydroponic conditions as well as in soil. The hyacinth was an issue like any other water body. It was arrested by creating vetiver bombs only through the geologues. And then such floating platforms were floated. And you can see after 2 months, the growth was wonderful because the vetiver plant uses this waste from the water as nourishment in this cyclical process of cleaning the water body. And over a 3 months period, the growth was wonderful. And we added few flowering plants, which also have remediating qualities like the Canna indica with flowers. This looks good. And there was also a solar aerator installed inside as an integrated system to oxygenate the water body. So you can see the clear difference before and after in 3 months time only in this water body. I shared this example in little detail due to shortage of time. I'll fast forward the other projects. There's a Mithi River rejuvenation project, which is currently underway, organized by the Mumbai Metropolitan Regional Development Authority. This was implemented in 2020, and this had received great media attention also. The Mithi River is a tidal impacted river and having semi-saline conditions. And since it is a flowing water, so what was tried was initially to have a case study or a pilot case with limited number of plants. These you can see the 2 meter or 1 meter floating platforms, and to test whether it is working on this kind of river in a controlled condition. It had given good results, and it is near the Bandra Kudla complex. It is soon to be scaled up. Then you have heard of being in Kolkata about the Patuli floating market, which was initially constructed by KMDA. In 2020, a river, the floating market water body rejuvenation project was taken up, and it had very bad quality because of the market. The waste from the market was dumped directly into the water body. And behavior change is one issue that needs to address this, we understand. But for the short term, the water was almost stinking. So this bioremediation, a biorejuvenation method was initiated through KMDA. And as you can see that the water body was, the water quality improved greatly, and the plants also showed good growth in this kind of environment. So this was another project which really made the floating market greener. Trash and weed control is an issue I shared before, and it was done through some innovation using this kind of trash booms, where you plant the vetiver directly through geologues in this kind of channels that acts as a boundary for the all kinds of trash and the water hyacinth as well. Embankment protection or soil stabilization is another part. Belaghata Canal restoration project was done under the Irrigation and Waterways Department, Government of West Bengal, in 2019. So 500 and 500 meter, that is 1 kilometer total stretch on both banks, was initiated. And the banks were in a very dilapidated condition, and often you had water or silt falling down. So stabilization was required. It was done in this particular manner as shown in the sketch. And you can see that in the same way, through geotextiles, using local jute, the vetiver managed to stabilize this bank. And over a period of time, the dumping of plastics and refuse material from the passersby stopped. And gradually, it became a wonderful view to look at. The bank beautification happened. A challenging project was in Bankura Canal Embankment Stabilization, also by the Irrigation and Waterways Directorate Department in 2019. So this Bankura embankment, this is almost 400 meter stretch and almost 50 meters high. So this stretch along the canal, an irrigation canal, was of kaolin soil, which is a very crystalline kind of material and does not allow much much stability in the soil. So constantly it was being drained upon with rains and floods, and it was polluting the canal and silting of the canal. So a similar intervention was taken for soil stabilization using geotextile and bamboo pegs. And as you can see here, you can see Mr. Kumar is there. So as you can see that use of jewel logs, it helped to stabilize. In this kind of soil also, what is important to learn, what was the learning lesson here, was that in this kind of soil also, the vetiver grass performed well and the growth was tremendous. So you can see that the embankment is fully stabilized right now, and 20,000 square meter of embankment is stabilized. Similar stabilization happened in Jamalpur in the Damodar Riverbank stabilization. As is common, that boulder pitching is an engineering intervention done by most departments, but this is unsuitable as there is no pegging in the ground. And once the water, the soil erodes, the boulder is also gone. So similar intervention was done to stabilize, and it is still there. Then in 2015, way back, there was the Chandrabhaga River stabilization project near the Bakreshwar thermal power plant. This place was dumped by fly ash, and the fly ash, what it did was it was choking the river. So occasionally the authorities would excavate the dumped fly ash to stabilize it and keep the river channel flowing, but it was very, very unstable. So what was done again, the intervention through vetiver plantation was done. And one challenging area was in 2015, it was found that as is common in West Bengal, floods happened, submergence happened, and almost for 10 days, the entire belt was submerged. So we had thought that the vetiver had died, but you can see that the vetiver tip is still visible. And after the floods receded, what you see is the road, the tractor road leading to the dam, that had gone, that has vanished because of the flood. But the embankment, which was planted upon by the vetiver, was still standing. So it now acts as a clear bund, and it is proof that the stabilization is very lasting if done with, done properly with vetiver. Then fly ash dump stabilization was done in 2014 in Dadri. It was a project by the National Thermal Power Corporation. And fly ash, as I was saying, is a very unstable material. So the authorities tried to stabilize it through immense amount of water usage. A great amount of water wastage happened to sprinkle the waste so that it does not fly into the neighboring lands. But this is not a lasting solution, they knew, but they had no other option. Then it was the same intervention which was tried, but the challenge here was whether vetiver would perform or grow at all in fly ash without soil. As you can see that before and after, the vetiver did grow well in even in fly ash conditions. And these areas have this great threat of having cavities in between where people might just go inside. So an accidents can happen. So this was stabilized through use of geotextile, similar technology, and the fly ash dump site has been stabilized, biostabilized. A larger challenging project happened recently in 2021. Where the Bokaro Power Supply Corporation engaged the services of in government of Jharkhand, and they had this dump site which was constantly blowing and creating nuisance, and it is a 100 meter high slope and 80 meter wide. So again, this kind of stabilization was tried, and this is the largest or highest stabilization so far that has been tried in a fly ash dump, and it is successful. Livelihoods generation is a very important part in this entire effort. The local population, the unskilled population, gets a lot of livelihood when this kind of projects happen, both in the back end and in the forefront. And also the vetiver production facility, which is presently in Kerala, is also getting a boost. Now, in livelihoods generation, 2-3 capacity building is a very important part, where local nurseries can be contracted to propagate this vetiver and supply the slips, as you have seen. local maintenance can be done using the community, and the local people can be taught regarding the other uses of vetiver also. So once the vetiver is cut, the stems are cut and the roots are cut, they can be reused into beautiful handicrafts like this, mats and the utensils like this, and this is good market. However, having said all these short-term projects, the longer goal still remains if market linkage happens or not. This cannot be as a standalone government project with academics participating and that's it. Unless and until the market comes in, this synergy does not happen and the local participation does not happen. So for that, we know that like any other business, we require raw material, investment, we require revenue and maintenance. And for revenue, the water can be thought of being recycled because there is a need for water in many areas, like direct selling to farmers, like industrial water buyback, tourism, transportation, the canals. City like Kolkata, having so many canals is a great means for green transport or blue transport. And then the recreation, of course. The developed countries who have realized this faster have done this in a similar way only. It is not very not very complicated, but we have to do it. So the learning lessons are adaptive integration, where existing urban water bodies can be used as wastewater management basins, which the NIU and NMCG is trying to do, I believe. And my take was more on in-situ intervention through bioremediation and phytoremediation. And also the market linkage is to work backwards to assess how much wastewater has potential for recycling in the industry and the in the agricultural markets especially, and then to produce accordingly. As Albert Einstein had said, that look deep into nature and then you will understand everything better. So I was trying to just do that. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Thank you so much, sir, and for sharing your work along with us. And I must say that there is a series of nice work, sir, that in the participation of yours, definitely participant and me myself get a huge knowledge from this presentation. Thank you so much for this presentation, sir. So now today,
Mr. Pradeep Kumar also, because he has been a great motivating force behind this entire effort.
Okay, sir. Yeah. Thank you so much for let us know these also. Thank you, Pradeep Kumar, sir, for the presence. And now we reached at the question answer session for the presentation. Participant having any question, you can write also, and you can ask also, and can raise your hand also. So the question answer, if anybody having question, please ask.
Sir, I have a question. Thank you, sir. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yes, Manas, you are audible. Go ahead.
First of all, thank you, sir, for your very informative presentation. It's a lecture. Sir, my query is basically on if we plant vetiver on Sundarban, the banks along the Sundarban, which is very much vulnerable. So can we plant this grass in this area? And is it useful for that area?
Yes, thank you very much for this question. It is a very relevant question standing at this point of time. And with the initiative of Honorable Chief Minister of West Bengal, such an intervention has already started, where the Sundarbans and the coastal areas like Digha are being thought of to strengthen through vegetative intervention. So the vetiver is a very potent plant, but the issue is how to use the vetiver. It is not that simple to just go and plant it, but depending on the particular site specific conditions, the bioengineering has to be designed and accordingly the vetiver has to be implemented. But certainly you are right that vetiver is the key ingredient in this entire effort.
Okay, sir. Again, I have a question. Sir, is there any role of local people in related to, the role of local people related to vetiver plant?
Yes, you have seen in the presentation that since not very highly skilled worker is required, both for the implementation and the maintenance. So role of local people becomes very crucial. It is good for community generation, community livelihood generation also. And that can be actually designed and thought of, and capacity building can happen so that local people can participate. We have seen that in most projects where, like for example, the STPs, where there is not much participation of the local community. It is mostly a government-run project. So there is not much local appreciation for the project. But if local participation happens right from the very beginning, there is appreciation, and as well as they become the custodians of the project.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Any other participant can ask? Okay, there is our another speaker, Professor Amit Hajela, sir. But unfortunately, he will not able to join along with us, and he will not able to present and deliver the as a speaker. He will not able to present today because of some personal emergency in his home. So he just informed us about that. So that is the unfortunate for all of us for today. We reached at the end of our session today, and for that I would like to say something that we reached at 2 days national level, at the end of the 2 day national level session on restoration of riverine ecosystems and urban planning. In both days we able to know and found some key points which going to be useful in our working areas. I feel very enriched today, and myself on behalf of SIARD team would like to express heartily thanks to our speaker, Professor Kaushik Ghosh, for his presence and for such nice presentation, and gave knowledge and grace us with his findings, experience and opinions. I would like to express my thanks to Rajiv Ranjan Mishra, sir, for sharing his work and about how collectively we need to come together as organization to restore riverine ecosystem. And I would like to extend my thanks, Dr. Tapati Banerjee, for providing more points about basin management. I would like to express my thanks to all the listeners, participants for their active presence, patience, and encouragement. I would like to express my gratitude to each team member of SIARD and NIMT. Still, if any other question is there, you can ask till now. For the conclusion, I would like to... Yes.
Ma'am, may I ask some question?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. First of all, thank you for your wonderful lecture. And I just wanted to know that in the present scenario, and the theme which we have kept particularly for that webinar, that is the restoration of riverine ecosystem and urban planning. So you were working since a very long time as a trainer in ATI, in Government of West Bengal, and you have trained lots of people. So according to you, so what should be the next capacity building modules or training components which we have to focus particularly for that river restoration, river ecosystem restoration and urban planning risk sectors? What are the points we have to focus in future?
Thank you. That was a very essay type question for me, but thank you. Because it requires a lot of points that needs to be addressed. But I'll try to be short. When we talk about capacity building, it is not just about training, as we all know, because training is one component of capacity building. Once we train someone, we also need to see that what he has done after the training, whether he has developed capacity in his implementation or in his activities or not. Now, once capacity is built, then we can be assured of good results. For that, if we look at such interventions of river rejuvenation worldwide, you will find that many South Asian countries have done this in a very integrated way, where ultimately it is the humans who are polluting the river. So it is the humans who should be trained, or capacity building should happen for the humans who should make it make the river come back to its original quality. So for example, Manila and Thailand and Philippines, there are examples where there have been river warriors trained by the local administration into how to take care of the river and what to do and what not to do. Similar initiatives are also being taken in Africa, in Kenya, where the local population has come forth and they know specifically what they have to do. When we talk about capacity building from a government level, as in our institute, we are dealing only with the officials of the government or the municipal functionaries. But when it comes to an organization like yours, the scope is limitless. You can train anybody and everybody. So the first point I would feel would be to identify the real stakeholders for every project and then to customize the training according to them. It can come forth from local population. For example, a mission like the National Urban Livelihoods Mission, which is renamed as Swayam Siddha in West Bengal. There, the self-help groups contribute largely to the development of the municipalities. They are, I feel, an informal form of leadership in the governance, and they take up the projects and they implement a lot of things that the government can't do. The grassroots reach. Similar things can be identified with the help of self-help groups and local community to distribute the work of the river rejuvenation, the maintenance work of the river rejuvenation, and the capacity building. So maybe that can be looked upon. After that, then there is, of course, policy issues, and there are fund issues, and there are implementation issues for which the government bodies and the academics and the universities can always look into. So I feel that could be a good start.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your wonderful knowledge sharing. Now I would like to hand over to Munmun, please.
Yeah, I noted all the points suggested to us. So it will be really helpful for us to continue with the another sessions of capacity building to really help us, sir. So thank you so much once again. Thank you to everyone for making it such a nice and wonderful event. Yes, Shafat Rashid, you want to ask some question? Yes, you can speak out also and you can write also as you wish. I think you raise your hand. Okay, I think it's missed. Something missed there. So I think we reached at the end, sir. So my question is, okay, Shafad, write it now. Okay. Go ahead. Actually, we didn't able to hear you. So, yeah.
You can write, you can ask your question, Mr. Rashid.
Yes.
You can unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hello everyone. So my question is that the model of bioengineering.
Share your designation also with us.
Yeah, I'm a GIS analyst. I'm working on different hydrological modeling and urbanization. So my question is, bioengineering perspective. I'm working in Srinagar, so there's a one thing, there's a soil, the soil chemistry is different, the water table is different, so the slope is different, and we are in the seismic zone 5. So I just want to know something more about about the bioengineering, the plantation, how we are retreating the water bodies, and how we are going to plan and something like that. So I just basically, your presentation gave me a broader perspective of the bioengineering. I was not very much familiar with this model which you have presented in your presentation. So I'm really thankful that you have opened some doors in the bioengineering and gave a very detailed work progress in this bioengineering. So I just want to know, are there certain depending upon the different climatic conditions and the soil chemistry and soil type, so how we are going to proceed in this with particular to different areas?
Thank you for the question. If I have understood you correctly, you are implementing projects in Srinagar, Kashmir, right?
Yeah, and basically I'm working. Yeah,
you're working, and you want to know how this technology, bioengineering, can be useful there.
Yeah.
And so, as I shared in my presentation, that it is this intervention that requires design. What by design I mean, the right mix of microbial concentration and the right amount of plant use, and depending on the soil structure and the site structure, the right intervention has to be done. Although the projects look more or less the same, but there is a lot of thinking and design that goes behind. So if you have any specific project in mind, maybe we can contact outside this forum and we can discuss in detail how your particular intervention should be. One example I can give is, for example, for wastewater management, there are different kinds of wastewater. Some type of wastewater coming from, say, the tanneries of West Bengal, and some wastewater is mostly domestic wastewater. So depending on the type of wastewater and the water test analysis, we can determine the type of bacterial intervention that is required. So that will be more effective than a general general one size fits all intervention. Yeah, so that is the kind of design I'm talking about.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Hello. Yes, ma'am. In Srinagar, the temperature will be almost minus. Vetiver will not survive in zero temperature. You have to cover it with the leaf mold. Then only it will survive, because up to 4 degree to 50 degree Celsius, it will work very nicely. But if it is below 5 degree
zero
temperature,
yes,
you have to be very careful while selecting the variety.
Yes.
Normally, everywhere the South Indian variety is very popular, but the survival point of view, Srinagar is not an ideal place to test.
Yes.
I am right.
Yes. Because the temperature sometimes goes to minus 8.
Yeah, in minus, you know, it will not survive.
Yes.
Dr. Vincent is an authority in vetiver.
Yes.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Thank you. And
actually, thank you very much for giving me an opportunity to participate in this seminar. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
No, sir. Thank you. It's our honor that you have joined with us, and we are also welcome all the participants. If you have shared your knowledge, this is the group discussion on open platform basis. You can also impart your knowledge and share your experience also.
Snehlata ma'am is asking some question, I think. Yes, you can ask, ma'am. She's asking, like, what
I
is the
wanted to know that cost per square meter of this,
Yeah, ma'am, the cost has to be calculated depending on the site conditions, because it is specific to site. For example, a project in Bokaro would not cost the same as a project in, say, Ranchi, because transportation is involved, and then the site conditions, how much it requires. So, like in buildings or constructions, we have per square feet cost. There is no such standard cost like this. Although in government of West Bengal, we have managed to create a bill of rates for tender purpose, but that is suited only for West Bengal.
How much was that, sir?
No, it depends. It is not just one intervention, so we have to discuss it. There is no standard cost like that has been calculated. Okay. It is the cost of raw materials. We have to do a bill of quantities, and then we can say maybe how much is the per capita cost for that project. But it is way cheaper compared to conventional interventions or hardcore engineering interventions.
Okay. Yes. So, any other participant having any query?
Good afternoon, sir. Yes. I am from Anna University. My name is Johnny, assistant professor here. I have a query regarding tail end regulator which will be installed near the coastal, that means river, when it connects to the coast, it will be installed in that region. And do we really have any guidelines in say installation of this structure? And for the whole rejuvenation, does government provides any guideline books or something which could be useful for the implementation?
Can you please repeat your question? I could not get it properly.
Actually, is there any guidelines available from the government side?
From the government side.
To implement tail end regulators or any other structural measures that can be implemented to rejuvenate a river?
What do you mean by tail end regulators?
Tail end regulators means, say, during a say high tide line, the water okay. from the silt will be carried from the ocean to the land and from the land to ocean during the low tide plane. So this phenomenon happens during the high tide and low tide time. Mm-hmm.
I got it.
Yeah. For this, yeah. Do we have any?
Yeah. So about guideline, I cannot say because it is in a very nascent stage still. But about a project that has been presently ongoing in the coastal belt of West Bengal, such interventions where the tidal impact is there, high tide, low tide issues are there. So the design is being done accordingly. Maybe after we are done with the design, we can share and discuss that point. Where the line of vetiver should be and below that what should be there, those kind of intervention design is presently ongoing.
Okay, sir, I got it. But and sir, do we have any best practices kind of documents available in the net for this rejuvenation so that we can learn and implement?
There are laboratory experiments done worldwide. So around 32 laboratory experiments you will find done worldwide. I have papers on that also. But none of them, or I should say almost 90% of them, are laboratory experiments. But what I showed you today was real life scenarios, actual scenarios, where there are no control conditions, there are weather issues, and there are other local community issues, social issues. And based on all these issues, also how the intervention is performing is what we are studying right now.
Okay, so one point of time you will publish this as a material.
Yes. All this will be published soon. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
So I can sense, sir, that the thirst is not gone in anybody's mind. Everybody want to hear more from you, sir. So I think we're going to meet again in another capacity building program. Definitely we want to hear you more, sir. So now we reached at the end, sir. So I think once again, thanks to all of you for the present, for this participation and encouragement, sir. Thanks to all of you.
Thank you.